Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to the Delphi Economic Forum. Welcome to our session entitled Addressing the Public Debt Issue Post-Pandemic. We all know that, and we have already experienced that the pandemic changed our lives, changed everything, even the economy. But now there is a big question about what we will find in the future. How can we heal our wounds and how can economy recover? I hope that our esteemed panelists will be able fully to analyze the situation and give convincing answers to critical questions. Of course, it's from his or her own point of view. And let me introduce him to you. We are honored to have Mr. Klaus Regling joining us today. Welcome, Mr. Regling. Thanks for being here. As you may already know, Mr. Regling is the Managing Director of the European Stability Mechanism. Mr. Dimitris Tsakonas, welcome. Mr. Tsakonas is the General Director of the Greek Public Debt Management Agency. Ms. Effie, Achtsioglou, welcome. Ms. Achtsioglou is an elected member of the Greek Parliament with Syriza and former Minister of Labor, Social Security and Solidarity. And last but not least, Mr. George Zanias, welcome. Mr. Zanias has a great experience in the public and private financial sector, serving among others as Minister of Finance, and he is currently the Chairman of the Board of Directors of Eurobank and Vice Chairman of the Board of the Hellenic Banking Association. Well, I'd like to open our discussion with Mr. Regling, and I'd like to ask you, how does the current environment with low interest rates and increasing sovereign debt affect the debt sustainability assessments, and what does the situation affect Greece in particular?
Yes, thank you very much for your question. And as you said in the beginning, the pandemic indeed has changed everything, including the debt side and the way we look at debt sustainability. And for Greece, it's particularly important to assess this question because while debt levels have gone in all countries in Europe and most countries around the world, probably all countries around the world, in the monetary union, the debt level of Greece in terms of GDP is by far the highest. So that, of course, raises questions. But it's still in the assessment of the ESM clear at the moment we consider Greek debt to be sustainable. Because on the one hand, the debt is much higher, caused by the pandemic. But there are also other factors, and some of them were influenced by the pandemic, that work in the favor of countries with high debt. For Greece in particular, it's worth noting that the starting point, let's say the year 2019, was a good one. The fiscal situation of Greece was strong in 2019. So that is my first point to make on Greece, a positive point. A second positive point for Greece is that the debt structure of Greece is quite unusual, quite unique. And my institutions play a major role in that. EFSF and ESM have about 55% of all Greek public debt. And we give our loans with very long maturities. In the case of Greece, the average maturity is 31 years. And the interest rate that we charge is the interest rate that we pay in the markets, and we are rated AAA. So 55% of Greek debt, you only have an interest rate burden that corresponds to a AAA rating. So that's a second positive impact. A third positive element here is that interest rates for all countries at the moment are extremely low. And Greece also benefits from that. This is partly the monetary policy of the ECB, but also of the Federal Reserve, of all major central banks around the world. So global interest rates are low, and they are particularly low also because of the pandemic, because monetary policy reacted to that. But that's only half the story on interest rates. The next point is that spreads, Greek spreads compared to the highly rated sovereigns in Europe have become very small compared to 7, 8, 10 years ago. So that's also positive. And the final point in Greece's favor is that Europe agreed last year on a number of measures in response to the pandemic. The most important is the next generation EU package, and Greece will receive more out of that package than any other country in Europe in terms of GDP. And that will help Greece to, that's the intention, the objective, to that the money is used to stimulate public investment and reforms, which, if it all works, will grow, lead Greece to a higher growth path. So when I put all that together, high debt, but then a number of positive elements, it can all come together so that Greek debt remains sustainable. This is our baseline scenario. Of course, there are risks around that, there are implementation problems, there are challenges around that, but I think I stop here because we will come to that later.
You're right. We will take a second round of questions. Thank you very much. Mr. Tsakonas, will you please let us know how the Greek public debt can be sustainable, especially after the effects of the pandemic, and how likely is that we would face another round of a debt crisis?
Thank you very much for the question, and it's a great honor for me being in this panel with Mr. Regling, Mr. Zanias, and Mrs. Achtsioglou. Yes, first of all, let me start from the beginning. Beginning means a year and a half ago. Pandemic for Greece was, perhaps I'm exaggerating a little bit, but it was a unique opportunity. A unique opportunity because we took this opportunity in order to rebuild sooner rather than later our public debt portfolio, our yield curve, issuing bonds with sufficient liquidity, improving the secondary market's liquidity, narrowing the bid offer spreads, making our debt instruments, government securities, more attractive, increasing the appetite of investors invest in Greek government securities. This led, finally, to the narrowing of the spreads, plus what Mr. Regling mentioned just a couple of minutes ago, we face this historical low interest rate environment. The rebuilding of the yield curve is one of the, if you like, that provides, is a factor that provides a lot of flexibility and confidence as far as the term and the structure of the Greek debt portfolio. Let me remind you that despite the pandemic and despite what comes next, the Greek debt portfolio has a weighted average maturity of 20 years, has almost 98% is in fixed rate, so we have eliminated the interest rate exposure mainly due to the implementation of the medium, long, and short, medium, and long-term measures, but also due to the active management of the Public Debt Management Agency and of the Hellenic Republic. And more importantly, the time to net refixing, which is the combination, an index that combines the weighted average maturity and the fixed rate element, is close to 19 years. That means that the current actual annual interest payments is close to 5.5 billion, and this amount will remain stable for a long, long period of time, close to 19 years, as I mentioned before. Let me remind you, in order to give you let's say a clear picture of what happened in the past and what will happen in the future. In the year 2000, with an outstanding amount of debt far lower compared to the today's level or before, slightly before the crisis, the annual interest payments used to be close to 10 billion. Before the PSI, before 2012, this amount was close to 16 billion, and if the PSI didn't happen, this amount of annual interest payments could reach 17, 18, or even 19 billion. Now we have, we can reassure everybody that, as I mentioned before, the annual interest payments will not exceed the 5.5 billion for a long period of time. If we take this into account, plus the term structure, i.e. the maturity profile of the Greek public debt, this leads to the conclusion that the annual gross financing needs, which is the most important factor as far as the Greek debt sustainability is concerned, is in weighted average terms till the year 2060, which is our time horizon for the for debt sustainability analysis, i.e. the next 40 consecutive years, will not exceed or will be close to 10 percentage points of GDP. And please compare this number, this this percentage, with other Eurozone peers, which is close to a double size percentage. So all this to say that despite the fact that as we speak right now, we are facing a debt to GDP level of close to 200%, the annual gross financing needs, which is the most important index, and the term structure of the Greek public debt reassures, ensures that the Greek debt is sustainable, and in any case, Greece is going to meet its debt obligations under all circumstances for a long, long period of time. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Tsakonas. You will have the chance to come back on the second round. And Ms. Achtsioglou, what is your estimation about the challenges Greece's economy will face as we are leaving the pandemic behind? And how would you outline an effective recovery, a recovery plan for Greece?
Thank you very much. Let me start with a couple of facts. One of them has been repeated by the previous commentators. The first one is that the stock of debt is an important indicator, but it's not always the best tool to judge a debt sustainability. What is more important is the debt service burden as a share of overall expenditure. And as far as the Greek debt is concerned, we have some good news coming from the past, or positive indicators, as Mr. Regling said before. The first one is that there is a Eurogroup's agreement of the summer of 2018 on Greek debt restructuring, which paves the way for a sustainable debt in the medium term. So the Greek debt at the current situation is sustainable, and it seems that it will remain sustainable despite the current crisis and the huge drop of GDP. And the other relevant positive indicator is the fiscal buffer that has been built the previous years and which ensures market trusts for the time being. But does this mean, or do these means mean that there is no risk or there is no danger for the foreseeable future? Absolutely not. The environment, the current economic environment, is highly volatile. It's uncertain. It's mainly defined by the program, the bond purchasing program of ECB right now, the PEPP program, which keeps interest rates very low. And, of course, a program from which Greece is also very much benefited. So the question is, what will happen when this program ends, when PEPP ends, so in the spring of 2022? Will interest rates remain as low as they are now? Will they remain compatible with debt sustainability? Nobody can reassure that. So that means that Greece will need to sustain market confidence under much less favorable financing conditions than the ones that are applied right now. And the key factor will be growth potential, whether the country will be able to have a strong recovery. And what we need is a robust and sustainable recovery. So we need two things: quality of the recovery and duration of the recovery. And here is where the controversy starts, let's say. Whether the current government's plan for recovery is the one that guarantees such a recovery, and whether the European Union will take some different decisions with regard to the economic environment than the ones that applied before. Just a couple of words, and maybe I will comment on that later on. Our worry as an opposition party is that the government's plan is not for recovery is not an inclusive plan. So it is not a plan that targets inequalities and thus can be sustainable. So we have very much high worries about what will happen in the medium term. It does not target the current scars of the crisis. It does not heal the wounds that have been caused by the crisis. And at the European level, the question is and the discussion is whether we will return to the strict rules of the Stability Pact or whether there will be some other decisions, whether these rules will relax a little bit, whether there will be a transition period or a totally different approach to the economic environment than the one that we had, for example, during the fiscal crisis of 2008 and 2009. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Mr. Zanias, should we have further increased an already high public debt during the pandemic? What do you think about that?
Thank you very much for the question. It's very good to be here, maybe on the fifth year. I'm very glad to be with the other panelists here on the same panel. Your question, Mr. Perdikaris, is very interesting because, you know, when we got into the crisis in 2009, the debt was 129.5%. And, you know, before the pandemic, it was much higher than that, of course. However, the real question, other circumstances like this one, that is a pandemic, or other extraordinary circumstances like the war, is not whether you should borrow more and increase your debt. The question is whether you can borrow, really, because the needs are so huge on the, you know, socially, on the health front, of course, but also, as I'm going to argue, on the economic front, that you have to borrow money and spend it. We are really very thankful that the central banks reacted the way they reacted around the world and the developed world, and especially the ECB. They provided huge liquidity, and this enabled a lot of cheap borrowing that helps also in the sustainability of the debt. The thing is that without all this extra debt, you know, the situation would have been even worse on the debt front. That is, as a percentage of GDP, the situation could have been worse if we had did not have all this intervention into the economy. Because, you know, we have a pandemic, it's a temporary phenomenon. We need some bridge financing in order to support the health system, the economy. We need to contain recession. We need to reduce the permanent damage that can be done to the economy. It preserve, of course, operational capacity so that we can kickstart very quickly when the pandemic finishes. So it was very well justified. And under the conditions that it took place, really it is more sustainable now than it was 12 years ago. I think others also mentioned the sustainability, which is mainly due to the qualitative characteristics that I'm not going to repeat again of the Greek debt. I think Mrs. Achtsioglou also mentioned about the Eurogroup decision, which operates as a backstop, really, if there is a need to further fix the debt. But I hope we don't reach that point. In order to give you an example, really the debt will be stable or slightly declining if we have zero growth, zero surpluses, and only 2% inflation. It will be slightly declining or stable. But, you know, this is not a recipe that you put it in a safe, and you keep it there, you say, I have locked you inside, now you are locked sustainable, the debt. The situation is not like this. Because, you know, the question of sustainability of the debt is a dynamic issue rather than a static issue. For that, we need, others said it also, we need sustainable growth policies. We need readiness to adapt because conditions, economic conditions change. You know, the interest rates will not remain forever where they are now. And bottlenecks exist. We know about business cycles, we know about all that. I will tell you, and I will finish with this, something that Jean-Claude Trichet, who was in the first crisis in the Eurogroup, the head of the ECB, said. You know, in 2010, we were discussing about the Greek crisis and the Irish crisis, because the Irish crisis could have been more severe, because Ireland had a banking sector 6 or 7% times of the GDP. Jean-Claude was saying at the Eurogroup, I'm not so much worried about Ireland, which could potentially have a larger problem but I'm worried about Greece. And the reason is that the Irish economy is a very flexible economy. So we have to be ready and adapt really to changing conditions and have a flexible economy. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Zanias. Mr. Regling, again, you focused on sustainability. And I'd like to ask you, what are the critical challenges for Greece in ensuring debt sustainability?
Yes. So, as everybody said, and we know, debt has been going up strongly, but that was the right response to the pandemic. So nobody at all is criticizing the Greek government for running very large fiscal deficit. All countries in Europe did that. A very, very clear consensus in the Eurogroup and the 3% deficit ceiling of the Stability and Growth Pact was suspended with a unanimous vote in the Council proposed by the Commission. And that was the right policy conclusion. Also, the very active monetary policy of the ECB helped, as was said. So all that was good. But, of course, with the high debt, there are vulnerabilities. As everybody also said here on the panel, there are risks and vulnerabilities. Now, there are some factors that are important to look at which the Greek government cannot influence. The Greek government cannot influence the general monetary policy of the ECB or the monetary conditions worldwide. But the Greek government can influence the spread in the market, the spread that Greece faces in the market. The Greek government must address the underlying problem of the Greek economy and has to try to stimulate growth by promoting productivity, by looking at the demographic challenges of the Greek labor market, making best use of the next generation EU package, and then, of course, also decide on the fiscal path. So these are the areas that are under the direct control of the Greek government. And these are big challenges. I think they are manageable, and that's why we from the ESM say debt is sustainable, not under all conditions, but if the government takes the right decisions on the reform side, then also markets will react positively. We have seen that. They look very carefully. Then the spread for Greek debt compared to AAA-rated sovereigns will remain low. Then productivity can be brought up with the right reforms and with the help of the next generation EU package, because that is there to promote public investment and reforms. Policies to mitigate the negative demographic trends that Greece faces, like many other countries in Europe. It's not something that is specific to Greece. Also, other countries have a shrinking labor force. But I think here in Greece, there are ways, and the government is already looking into that or taking measures to raise the participation rate of women, for instance, of older people, trying to bring some of the young, well-educated Greeks back into Greece who left during the crisis, which is something that worked well in other European countries. I remember very much Poland and Portugal, where also the well-educated people left in a crisis or after joining the EU. But when the economy did well, they went back home. I think with the right policy, that's also a possibility for Greece, and that would definitely improve the demographic outlook and the size of the labor force, which is one important factor for determining growth. Reforms are needed to raise productivity, like in many other countries. And then there's a question of what to do on the fiscal side, of course. During the pandemic, as I said, it was the right policy response to increase the deficit significantly. And everybody was in agreement with that. All the other EU member states did the same thing. And that meant for Greece abandoning temporarily the agreed fiscal targets. That was the right response, and everybody supported that. But of course, eventually, Greece has to return to a different kind of fiscal policy, not run a fiscal deficit of almost 10% of GDP like last year. But to a large extent, this will happen almost automatically as the temporary measures that were taken in response to the crisis will expire. That will bring the fiscal balance back from deficit to surplus. And so I'm not very worried about this. The stability program that was submitted by the Greek government to the European Commission shows very clearly that Greece intends to return to the previously agreed fiscal path. So that, I think, is well under control. And the focus has to be how to promote growth through productivity gains and strengthening the labor market.
Thank you, Mr. Regling. Mr. Tsakonas, I'm a possible investor. Okay, I wish I were. But how can you reassure me that there's no risk in investing in Greek government securities, even if Greece has not reached the investment grade status yet?
Thank you for this challenging question. Following Mr. Regling's way of thinking, I want to stress that the Greek economy and the Hellenic Republic is a machine that produces primary surpluses, especially after the implementation of three consecutive fiscal adjustment programs and a large number of structural reforms. As far as assuming that we have a problem, the problem is a fraction. We have on the numerator the Greek public debt, and on the denominator we have GDP. As far as the numerator is concerned, we are done. We are done because we have managed to immunize the Greek public debt portfolio from all risks, market risks, interest rate exposure, FX exposure close to zero, and as I mentioned before, the term structure and the time to the net refixing reassures and ensures that the Greek debt will be manageable, will be the Hellenic public will meet its obligation, obligations under all circumstances for a long, long period of time. I need to stress once again that we have also not just the 10% of GDP versus GDP weighted average gross financing needs for a long period of time, for the next, let's say, 30 or 40 years in weighted average terms, but also we have aside a cash reserves that, as we speak right now, are close to 33 billion euros. Although we spent a lot the last 2 years due to the pandemic, still we have this big amount of cash reserves that reassures what I've just mentioned before, that the Hellenic public, even if it's not going to have any access, further access to the capital markets, is ready to cover its gross financing needs for 3 or even more years. On top of this, I need to stress that one of the biggest, perhaps, structural reforms that we implemented was the one that I've just mentioned, i.e. the holistic approach and integrated cash management of all general government entities, including the Greek state. Last but not least, we are going to continue the dialogue with the investors community. We are going to provide more supply. We are going to make our secondary market more efficient, providing more tradable securities, reducing the bid-offer spreads and the transaction costs, and therefore making our Greek government securities attractive to investors. One additional element that an investor should take into account in order to invest in Greek government securities is the holders of this of the public debt. I do realize that there are a lot of there is a nasty past as far as investors is concerned regarding investors that used to be holders of Greek government securities. This comes from the vast past, this nasty fact and history. But now, as Mr. Regling mentioned before, the vast majority of the Greek debt is held directly or indirectly by the official sector, more than 70%. If we add on this amount what has been absorbed, has been bought recently due to the PPP from ECB That means that the free flow of Greek government securities, that the amount that is held by investors is tiny, so there is no possibility to repeat, let's say, the nasty surprise that investors faced in the past. All this to say that whatever it takes, last but not least, we are going to do whatever it takes in order to preserve the current status, if not to preserve, also to improve the current status of the Greek government securities, and I'm referring to the ECB's eligibility. This is a given fact. This is a decision that has been taken, and there is a consistency as far as this decision is concerned. We have a plan. The plan has been designed since 2012. What we are seeing right now is the implementation of this plan. We keep the consistency, and PDMA is a concrete element that the Greek state has continuity, has institutional memory and consistency. I think that is sufficient to convince investors to invest in Greek government securities.
Thank you. And Ms. Achtsioglou, can Europe make any alternative choices with regard to fiscal policy? And what do you think? What are the aspects of on the stability pact rules?
So, as I said before, and I see that also Mr. Regling agrees with this principle, is that the growth potential is the key factor right now, how to promote growth. And there are two elements that really affect this. On the one hand is the choices that the Greek government will make in order to heal the wounds from the current crisis, and also on how it will use the very important package, the RRF funding. Our concerns lie on both sides because we do not see how the wounds from the crisis are healed. There is no such plan, and I'm talking about private debt, I'm talking about the danger of SMEs, permanent shutdown, I'm talking about preserving job positions. These are not currently guaranteed by any plan, so there is no plan, direct plan for the restart of the Greek economy. And on the other hand, the growth strategy of the government presented in order to use the RRF funds has some major flaws with regard to inequalities. So it does not target inequalities, it does not target social exclusion, and it leaves the majority of the SMEs outside the investment process. So it is for these reasons that we believe that this is not a plan that includes the majority of the society. It's a plan that leaves the many behind. So this is the one part of the concern. The other part has to do with what the European Union will decide, what decisions will make on the fiscal path, whether there will be changes in the Stability Pact, whether we will rethink the goals, the quantitative goals set by the Stability Pact, which are rigid rules, strict rules, and whether we will rethink the philosophy of the Stability Pact. We believe that there should be these changes, and we believe that this is the time that such a discussion should take place. If there are no changes there, it is highly likely that Greece will also need to engage sooner or later in fiscal adjustment. And this will definitely negatively affect the growth potential. There is an interesting example that comes from outside the European Union and is Biden's administration, which right now applies a different package, a package twofold. It targets the current wounds of the crisis. It also focuses on enhancing the income of the low-income households. And it has two advantages. The first one is that I believe it is more stimulus, exactly because it focuses on consumption and on low-income household. It is possible that it will bring results faster than the Greek, let's say, program. And the second advantage is that it is more inclusive than the Greek package, because it tackles inequalities, social exclusion, and expands labor rights. So I believe that this is an interesting reaction to the current crisis coming from the USA, and it will be important to take it into account and to rethink about our policies towards this direction.
Thank you, Ms. Achtsioglou. Mr. Zanias, you have already described a bit how the current crisis, the current public debt situation, to be more precise, compared with the beginning of the debt crisis. But I'd like to ask you, how likely is that the new austerity measures may be required to deal with the situation?
Thank you very much, Mr. Perdikaris. The short answer is no. Even the IMF really says no. You know, in the autumn, the IMF says no and encourages public investment. The main reason really for saying no is that the vast majority of the measures that have been taken now are what we call one-offs. That is, they are valid only for 2020 and 2021. And then they go off. So gradually, as the GDP recovers to the 2019 levels, the surpluses will return, most of that. There are only two or three really measures, like the reduction in the social contributions, the reduction in property taxes, corporate taxes, which account for 2 or 3 billion altogether. And this is the only thing that's not one off. Otherwise, there is no problem. No new austerity, for sure. Now, this is a completely different situation, really, compared to, 10, 11 years ago. Because now, the problem of at that time, the problem of the country was competitiveness. Okay, we have solved considerable part of this problem. Also, the problem of the country was that Europe was different than it is now. Even the ESM did not exist at the time. It was created in 2010. Even, what we call the economist lender of last resort, which usually the central banks operate, did not exist. In 2012 started to exist with the outside monetary transactions. So now everything is very different. Therefore, I believe that gradually we will return close to where we were before. Don't forget that, when the pandemic came, the last year before the pandemic, we had a surplus, primary surplus, of 4.4%, despite some decreases in property taxes that had taken place within 2019 and some other measures, really.